Radiation. Dr. Tokio Maz is currently a research fellow at the Forum Transregionale Studien in Berlin, in Germany, as well as the Kazan visiting professor. Meanwhile, he's working on his book manuscript based on his dissertation, Rethinking Genocide, Violence and Victimhood in Eastern Anatolia, 1913 to 1915, which concerns the conflict in Eastern Anatolia in the early 20th century and the memory politics surrounding it. And tonight, he will be presenting one special aspect of his research, which focuses on Van and the Vasburagan region. And the title of his lecture is Van Vasburagan Armenians, From Renaissance to Resistance and Genocide. Please welcome Dr. Tokio Maz here to Fresno State. We're very, very happy to have you.
Thank you very much, Sergio, for this great introduction. Can you hear me well? Profesör Sergio Laporta'yı, Manina Zakyan'ın, Jim Karagözyan'ın, Peggy Akbilkyan'ın, Yevnaya, Anşöşt, Emo Sonovner'ın, İnziyan İrenz, İnziyan Antep Sürç Dıvats, Ankın Adeli, Yer Çerm İntunutiyum, Yer Açak Tutyan Hamal, Yer Kuzem Ser Olorin, Volçunel, Ays İrikun Ser Arçak Kosevi, İnsaman Met Hacı, Yer Met Badive. Pariye bak. I should begin with expressing my gratitude to the Armenian Studies community for such a warm welcome, and especially to Dr. Barlo Dermigirdichyan, Professor Sergio Laporta, Malina Zakyan, and also to Jim Karagözyan and Peggy Akbilkyan, and to my students for making my transition from Berlin to Fresno so smooth and enjoyable. And I thank you all very much for being here at this beautiful Fresno night, evening. Okay. Yeah. I'm truly honored to be speaking here about Van Vasburagan, a site which has preoccupied me for at least 10 years. I was conducting research at the Armenian National Archives in Yerevan for my dissertation, exploring the inter-elite and state-community relations on the eve of the genocide, when I first stumbled upon a file of documents on Van. As my research progressed, Van became a focal region for my project, as I realized that understanding the socio-political nexus in Van was the most challenging and promising endeavor. This location never stopped urging me to question and rethink many of our foundational presumptions in historical reconstruction about the Armenian genocide, about the Ottoman statehood in border zones, about the relations within and between communities, starting with what a community has meant, and about living in a cosmos where imperial rivalries, interests, and networks meet. Hence, the shadow of Van as Vasburagan has haunted my work to this day. Today, through a brief overview of the history of Van Vasburagan, I would like to underscore the ways in which studying this particular location challenges the conventional understanding of history, and I will also try to suggest potential ways of opening up new horizons in rewriting the history of Van in various contexts. Things that I would like to think through with you. I have to confess that my first visit to Yerevan in the summer of 2002 was a major moment of epiphany for me. from the famous cognac to taxi stations, from restaurants to travel agencies, from printing houses to football teams, from medical centers to radio stations, the names Van and Vasco da Gama were everywhere. It was my first realization that the memory of Van haunted the city. Van has never been a focus for Turkish nationalist narratives, with the exception of the so-called the Armenian Rebellion, of course, nor the Kurdish histories grant a comparable importance. In the Armenian nationalist imagination, on the contrary, Van is a more significant historical location, the birthplace of the nation and the center of Armenian dynasty. Publications in no other language can approach the volume of literature that exists in Armenian language on Van. The beautiful city and the surroundings decorated by monumental monasteries that reflect the grandeur of Armenian arts and architecture. It's also the most emblematic site of Armenian heroism and resistance. And to be honest, Vanites, that is the people of Van, have good reasons to underscore Van's significance. Let me begin with my title. I use the term Vaspro Agam intentionally. This toponym, which literally means belonging to the aristocrat class, dates back to 9th century BC, but more widely known and used for one of the 8 provinces of Medhike, that is Greater Armenia. I'm not highlighting this term to adhere to a brand of Armenian nationalist geographic imaginary, nor to the myth of Golden Age, but I insist to use it because it offers a lynx-eyed socio-spatial lens that neither Vaninahank, Van Vilayeti, nor Van Ili can. The term Vaspuragan reminds us resolutely that our analytical vision has to transpass borders, both imperial and national. Historic Vaspuragan covered an area stretching from Khizan to Hoy, to Urmia, from Amidia to Nakhichevan. Hence, Vaspuragan was and has been a social, cultural, intellectual, and economic network that connected 3 empires, Ottoman, Russian, and Persian. Neither the Amasya Treaty of 1555, nor the Kastr-ı Şirin of 1639 could block the vivid cross-border osmosis. Even when states insisted on drawing borders, people remained connected through tribal networks, through revolutionary activism, through smuggling and through business. Goods, ideas, weapons, and bodies crisscrossed borders. This network has remained active until recent times, despite all governmental efforts to terrorize it, as was the case in 33 Kurşun, or Bullet, the massacre of Kurds crossing the border in 1943. Just a few examples to the traffic through Vaspuragan. As of 1880s, Van attracted the attention of Armenian intellectuals such as Rafi from the Caucasus, who helped create a new form of communal consciousness on all sides of the borders. During the Tebi Yergir, towards the homeland movement at the end of the 19th century, many Armenian revolutionaries flowed into Van from the Caucasus and Iran. Before the genocide, 2 chiefs of the Dashnak Committee in Van, Aram and Ishan, were Russian expats. For major businessmen of Van, such as Terzibashians, Kapamajians, and Tütüncians, Northern Iran and Russian Caucasus were vital marketplaces. Around 1910s, Mishak, the influential Tiflis-based Armenian newspaper, used to arrive in Van well before newspapers from Istanbul did. Centrality of Van was not limited to Armenians. The activities of proto-nationalist Kurdish leaders, such as Simko of Shikaks, Kör Hüseyin Pasha of Haydarans, or Abdurrezak Bedirhan, should also be located in the Vaspuragan network. Likewise, for state actors, the same area constituted one interconnected circuit for rivalry, seeking alliances, war-making, and even for exterminationist campaigns, more so particularly after the 1910s. So, right. Here are some maps of one Bashuragan. I use the term Bashuragan, which covers this area actually. Oops. Yes. This area which connects the three empires. And do you see here this today's one Ili? And here the map, the Ottoman map of one vilayeti. And here is the
version of it.
And this is a more detailed map as of 1818. In 1818, this northern Sanjak of Hakkari became part of one Sanjak. Those two Sanjaks were united. And the major concern was that one was an area Armenians had at least relative majority in demographically. And as you all know, after the Berlin Treaty, the population of Armenians was a very politicized and politicized issue. Armenians definitely made we don't have reliable numbers, but definitely made at least a relative majority. The second biggest group were definitely the Kurds. And the third, there was a sizable Assyrian community. Also lived Turks, Gypsies, and Yazidis, and a small community of Jews in the province. And the Assyrians were not like a level, but in a bigger communities in Hakkari Sanjak towards the south. Partially due to this interconnectedness, in the course of the so-called Armenian century of Zartong, or modernization, that's the long 19th century, leaving aside the myth and legends of the ancient history, Van truly became an increasingly notable center for Armenians. Economic, political, and cultural life went through a revolutionary transformation in the latter half of the century. Economically, the region prospered significantly thanks to leather and furniture industries and their trade. The same period also witnessed the importing of global actors such as missionaries and foreign consulates. Before the genocide, one, a landlocked and remote Ottoman city was increasingly well connected to the world through American and German missionaries as well as British, Russian, French, and Italian consuls. New schools for boys and girls were opened. The first periodical Arzvi Bashuragan was published in Barakavang in 1858. Theater plays were introduced by Dikran Amirjanyan after 1867. At this conjecture, a new class of one elite emerged, an elite that developed fine Western taste, spoke a Western language, and was informed about political, literary, philosophical debates in Europe, America, and Russia. But beyond becoming a notable center for Armenians, Van was also a significant site where Armenianness was redefined into a modern national identity. If Constantinople, Tiflis, and Venice were the centers of Armenian modernization in the Ottoman Empire, Russia, and Europe, respectively, Van was the center of this process in Ottoman Armenian provinces. It should be underscored that Van was not simply a passive recipient of new ideas and imaginaries, but was also a place that inspired all major Armenian cultural political centers and locations elsewhere. I think it would suffice to recall Arzvi Bashuragan, the eagle of Bashuragan, Khrimian Haydik. His strong inspiration in transforming an ethno-religious community into a modernizing nation by introducing themes of heroism from Armenian antiquity and juxtaposing them with the sufferings of Ottoman Armenians. One should also remember Migirdiç Portakalyar and his emphasis on the modern education for national liberation. I should add to this list Karakin Sırbanksyan, who, although being a cleric, compiled folk narratives in local vernaculars and processed them into the well-known national epic, Sasuntsi David, whose statue the city of Fresno houses today. In short, studying one allows us to see non-conventional ways of Armenian modernization and nation building. And it invites us to rethink, especially the prevailing political thought and activism among Ottoman Armenians. It also suggests that for the Armenians of the provinces, the so-called Zarton was not simply a set of imported ideas from Europe, Constantinople or Tiflis, but there was noteworthy local input in the process. Within the debates around the Armenian nation building, the intervention of one intellectual was particularly significant and peculiar on two grounds. First, regarding the modernization of the language, both Hrimyan Haynik and Cervantians advocated a unified vernacular, yet, unlike the elites in East Constantinople, they proposed that classical Armenian should be taken as the base and that it should be enriched with the lexical wealth of local dialects, especially the Van dialect. This was a call to the Armenian intellectuals of Constantinople to turn to Yergir, to the country, instead of running to Western dictionaries. Second, almost all Vanati intellectual pioneers of modernization, Hrimyan Haynik, Portakalyan, and Cervantians alike, rejected the notion of victimhood. Not surprisingly, the protagonists in their writings were the heroes in the Armenian history who fought against oppressors. Particularly Portakalyan wrote against the widespread use of fatalistic expressions in the everyday language. Likewise, noteworthy was Hrimyan Haynik's metaphor of iron ladle, which suggested that Armenians should struggle themselves to achieve liberation. This metaphor would have weighty influence on the radicalization of Armenian activism in the post-Berlin Treaty period. Finally, and in this way, the earlier schools opened by Hrimyan Haynik, such as Jarangovarat and Portakalyan Getonagan Varjaran, would be the venues where the next generation of Vanati intellectuals with revolutionary ideas and activism were trained. The ongoing intellectual transformation also gave way to the emergence of earliest pioneering Armenian nationalist organizations in Van in the 1870s, such as Mutyun, Upurgutyun, and Sevhach. Yet on the political scene, the most significant would come with the formation of the first Armenian political party in 1885 in Van, the Armenekan Party. Ideologically, the party, inspired by Portakalyan's radical ideas about national liberation, would starkly differ from the other two major parties to be formed a few years later, the Hegelpogagan Tashnakstun and the Social Democrat Hunçakyun Party. Armenians envisioned an armed struggle, and yet they never adhered to a socialist program. The deeply rooted presence of the Armenians in Van singled the province out as the only location where there was a well-organized and armed nationalist yet liberal group. It was the Armenian presence that rendered Van, along with Sasun, as one of the few sites of resistance in 1896 during the Hamidian massacres. Armenians would also play a decisive role during the resistance in 1915. However, the Hamidian massacres marked a turning point in the history of the province in terms of the level of destruction, migration, configuration of intercommunal relations, and perhaps most importantly, in terms of what Armenians meant. Now, I would like to turn to the constitutional period of 1908-1914. Let me start by emphasizing that for Ottoman Armenians, July 1908 indeed marked a double revolution. First, a revolution in the capital by the Young Turks against Abdülhamid, and second, a revolution within the Armenian community, best symbolized by the forced resignation of Patriarch Magakia Koren Ormanyan. For the Ottoman Armenian community, Ormanyan's dismissal pointed to the beginning of a radical shift of political power, signaling the end of Patriarch's leadership. One early and major consequence of the Young Turk Revolution was the parallel replacements of spatial symbols of political power, from Abdülhamit Yıldız Palace to Baba Ali, and later to the military garrisons, and for the Armenian community, from Patriarchate in Kumkapı to Pera, where Armenian party offices and newspaper headquarters were located. During the constitutional period, among the three political parties, the Taşnak Sütun effectively and aggressively utilized its alliance with the Young Turks for two purposes. First, to progressively replace the position of the Patriarchate as the representative of Armenians before the Ottoman state. Second, to marginalize its political rivals within the community. Yet the ideological grounds of the Taşnak-CUP alliance were very thin, little more than a common opposition to the very loosely defined threat of counter-revolutionary reactionaries. More important was, I suggest, the institutional interest of the sides. One province is a very striking laboratory to see the workings and consequences of this institutional power game. Even before the Young Turk Revolution, particularly after 1904, Taşnak Sütun was quite active as an underground organization in Van. As of 1907, Van became one of the few localities where there was joint Young Turk Taşnak Sütun activism against Abdülhamit II. On the eve of the revolution, however, many of the Taşnak activists, including Aram Manukyan, were arrested and the party's ammunition caches seized after a prominent party member, Tabos, betrayal. A few months later, the news about the revolution in Constantinople was heard. Soon, all of these detainees would be released, and they enjoyed the sudden shift from a potentially long-term conviction to actually being among the heroes of the new constitutional regime. Following the revolution, many more comrades from the Caucasus would join them in Van. A local chapter of the party was opened in the city. On November 7, 1910, the twice a weekly pro-Taşnak newspaper, Aşkadan, started publication. During the constitutional period, except a short time interval, party committees and leaders worked closely with the governors. The party triumvirate, Aram, İşhan, and Vramyan, were actively involved in provincial policymaking. These favorable conditions allowed the party to assertively expand its influence over the Armenian community institutions, such as schools, provincial community councils, and even churches. The party even enjoyed official leniency and, at times, support for its armed activities in the province. Armed trafficking and their distribution to Armenian peasantry was generally condoned. And, more interestingly, during times of anti-government movements, it was encouraged by local authorities. Furthermore, the Taşnak Party had an effective legal immunity regarding its actions within the Armenian community. In Van, the authorities usually agreed or looked the other way when Taşnak gunmen attacked other Armenians. And these gunmen were rarely, if ever, prosecuted. At times, Taşnak attacks against Muslims were also covered up, as long as authorities asserted that the event would not lead to general disorder or a Muslim Kurdish riot. The new dynamic, that is the alliance between the İttihadis and Taşnak Sütun, had significant impact on the intra-communal politics. The aggressive expansion of the party into educational and religious affairs and attacks provoked significant opposition and protests from the non-Taşnak Armenian groups, particularly the tensions and the rivalry between the Taşnak Sütun and the second most influential group, Armenakans, was fierce. and at times violent, both in the city and in the countryside. The Social Democrat and Chakian Party's influence, on the other hand, was limited only to a group of intellectuals in the city. In short, we should keep in mind that in one, on the eve of the genocide, the Armenian community was deeply divided along political lines. Let me now look more closely into the dynamics of the relations between the Tashnak student Itadis in one. The party terminated the alliance with the Young Turks in the Ottoman Empire in August 1912. However, despite this central decision, in one, alliance, cooperation, coordination, or at least negotiation between the Tashnak student and the Itadis could and did continue until April 1915. That is, until the genocide. Here I would like to explain why and how this could be possible. In one, after the Young Turk Revolution, relations between the Tashnak student and the government witnessed the coldest period during the term of the anti-Ittihadist İzzet Pasha's governorship between August 1912 and May 1913. After May 1913, however, series of events opened up a new page in the relationship. First was the assassination of the Armenian mayor of Van, Bedros Kapamagian. It was a public secret that murder was committed by the Tashnak gunman. A few months late after the killing, Governor İzzet Pasha issued a subpoena for the two chiefs of the party, Vramyan and Aram. That should be a problem, April or May 1913, implicating them in the crime. The Tashnak party openly rejected the subpoena and strongly protested it in a telegram message. 4 days later, the governor was dismissed, and soon after, the criminal case was closed. Before leaving Van, the dismissed governor contacted the party, proposing reconciliation and creating Armena Kurdish, because he had some, I think, Armenian Kurdish ancestry. But the Tashnak leaders rejected the offer, stating that they were not longing for his cooperation. This episode clearly illustrates the level of self-confidence the party had reached in the province. Second development was the appointment of Tahsin Bey as the new governor. Here, we should note that after the Balkan Wars, that is, after May, June 1913, the Ottoman state was a weaker network. The Ittihadists party felt especially vulnerable in the border province of Van, where, unlike Erzurum, for instance, it lacked a strong base support among the Muslims. They desperately needed the Tashnak student's backing, not only to secure compliance of Armenians, but also to counter potential challenges by the Kurdish insurgents, which the government feared were provoked and promoted by Russians. The Tashnak leaders in Van did not fail to assess the opportunities of this new panorama and adopted a novel tactical alliance. If the alliance between the parties was based upon revolutionary fervor, accompanied by comradely trust during the honeymoon of the Constitutional Revolution, if their cooperation was framed by unity against the common enemy of counter-revolutionary reactionaries and feudal elements, and the fear against them after the March 31st rebellion and Adana pogroms, if the alliance was in a vegetative state, accompanied by diplomatic coldness when the CUP lost power in 1912, in this new period, the new collaboration between the sides would be framed by what I call a utilitarian mutualism, emotionally accompanied by desire for more organizational, institutional power. Tahsin Bey's governorship was the epitome of the political climate and renewed relationships in the post-Balkan Wars period. Here is what I mean. In a letter to the party's party's Central Committee of America on November 20, 1913, Vramyan describes the outset of the relationships with the new governor. I quote, "The successor governor, that is, the governor after İzzet Pasha, Tahsin Bey arrived in Van, and he made it his priority to invite us to cooperate with him. promising to satisfy all our legitimate demands. In response, we stated him that we did not trust him, neither as official, as an official, nor as an Ittihadist, and that he should prove his sincerity with his work. He found our objection fair and requested from us to assess him according to his performance, unquote. After several meetings, the Daşnak Sütun raised its demands, which included, first, austere measures against Kurdish insurgents. Second, not to disarm the Armenians, handing the confiscated arms back to Armenians and to provide arms for the Armenian village guards. Third, 50% of the gendarme force to be composed of Armenians. Four, settlement of the land issue through administrative measures. Five, 50% of the official employees to be Armenian. Six, eradication of Hamidian troops. Interestingly, Tahsin Bey accepted almost all these conditions in principle, and even took some radical steps, such as returning the previously confiscated guns, and he also distributed rifles to some Armenian village guards. And he also started implementing measures to settle the issue of confiscated Armenian lands in the countryside. Apparently, the ARF put the governor, put the governor in front of a dilemma, either to put aside old methods of governance and agree to a utilitarian mutualism with the ARF or Daşnak Sütun to secure the loyalty of Armenians to the Ottoman state, or to be ready for all kinds of unexpected challenges, including what Vramyan called extreme means if they pursue an anti-Armenian policy. Vramyan observed that the governor had pretended to have been convinced by the Daşnak leaders assurances that the opportunities a free Turkish regime did and will provide for the Armenian people's progress made it to Daşnak Sütun's interests to defend the territorial integrity and existence of such a state. Vramyan was unequivocal about the lack of compassion in this utilitarian mutualistic relationship. I quote, You might ask, how sincere are they? Sincerity is tied to one's interests. This needs to be specified. A, the government has the fear of Russian invasion. For us, especially now, to provoke a turmoil and create excuses for Russian invasion is not difficult. B, the ARF's gradual strengthening, especially in Vaspuragan, it is that power which can create complications and justifications for European intervention. This is the reason why in Van, and recently also partly in Mush, actually, Vramyan also put the ARF leaders in Mush with the governor there, Nusret Bey, to make to negotiate on a similar kind of agreement or alliance by August 1913. That's the reason why in Van and recently also partly in Mush, the Turkish government is compelled to make concessions about which Armenians elsewhere, even in Karin, Erzurum, do not even have the courage to think about. Quite ironic in retrospect. In the 1914 elections, the Ittihadis and Daşnaks ran together in Van. Two Daşnak deputies, Vramyan and Papazyan, were sent to the parliament. Even the only Muslim representative to the Ottoman parliament from Van, public prosecutor Asad Bey, could only make it to the candidacy by receiving the local Daşnak committee's support and help. These intricate calculations and moves were not limited to the politics, but also extended to the social life in Van. Especially during the governor Tahsin Bey's term, Aram and İşhan were the most common invitees of governor's dinner parties, which usually lasted well into the night. with much drinking and toasting. The Tashnak chiefs often organized their own dinner parties, hosting the governor, military commanders, and other high-ranking officials. In his memoirs, Evlatyan, who was the Armenian Inspector General of Van, recalls one such gathering in April 1914. Governor Tahsin Bey had invited Van notables to a day-long picnic in Artamet on the coast of Lake Van. In the afternoon, according to Evlatyan, the governor called for a shooting contest. An egg was placed 100 meters away, and each contestant fired one shot at the target. The three contestants were, first, the military commander Kazım Bey, who would later take the surname Özal and serve as the Speaker of the Turkish Parliament and Minister of Defense. Second, an Iranian Kurd. And third, İşhan, the Tashnak commander of the party's military activities in Van. İşhan won the contest. Exactly 1 year later, İşhan would be the first high-profile victim of the genocide. Kazım Özal, on the other hand, as a military commander, would oversee the massacres against Assyrians and Armenians in Van and in northern Iran. In his letter to the Tashnak Student Central Committee of America, Ramyan described the Arab situation in this era in Van as the fructifying period of invaluable and countless sacrifices. The monumental party building under construction, the Ashkadanki Dome, designed by Hovhannes Kachasnuni, was indeed meant to epitomize the might of the Arab Tashnak Student in this fructifying period. The Arab had achieved such a powerful position in the province that not only it would have decisive power on governmental politics, it also began to be seen as a viable alternative and local power center for Kurdish notables, some of whom even contacted the Arab leaders, appealing their admission as party members. In a report drafted in 1919 on Van, Humayun Manukyan strikingly summarized party's organizational might on the eve of World War I. I quote, "The Arab in Baspuragan had reached the climax of its might. It was estimated that in its ranks there were 10, 12,000 organized comrades. All the committee institutions had passed to our control. Every word of the Ashkadan newspaper used to be deemed as a commandment, not only in the Armenian circles, but also by the government officials. For the ARF, a period of creative and constructive work had started." In short, in the course of the constitutional period, the Baspuragan Central Committee had been the author of creating a power balance that progressively worked on the party's behalf. Which, hence, when the World War began, the continuation of the existing matrix of power in the province, therefore, seemed the most beneficial scenario to the party committee. That is what the war precisely put at stake. So, Tashnak Student Central Committee in Van, unlike the Eastern Bureau in Tiflis, unlike some leaders in Istanbul, and unlike the cadres from provinces such as Sivas, Aintab, or Adana, the existing outlooks under a vulnerable Ottoman regime were more desirable than prospect of a Vanski gubernia under strong Russian control. Therefore, when the wartime strategy of the party was debated in the 8th World Congress in August 1914, what at the time was called Russian orientation, meaning the decision to support the Russian war strategy, did not offer appealing opportunities to the only delegate from Van to the Congress in Erzurum, Mihran Terlemezyan. But it would rather mean to put what had been attained at risk. That's exactly why the Tashnak chief Aram landed in the Armenian neighborhoods, especially in Aykastan, of course, with Dahol and Zurna and connected Armenian youth, almost all Taşnak student members, to sign up for as Ottoman soldiers in the early days of the military mobilization in July 1914. In the course of the sudden escalation of tensions after October 1914, the Taşnak leaders had to play a very delicate chess game. Arshav Bramyan, the one deputy to the parliament, would be a key negotiator in mediating the tensions, clashes, and exchanges with the CUP representatives, as well as with his comrades in Tiflis and in Iran. You know, his comrades are in Tiflis and Iran. He was particularly in close contact with Ömer Naci and Ittihadis from the party's inner circle, who was in northern Iran at the time, the ex-governor Tahsin Bey, who was in Erzurum as the Vali or governor of Erzurum, and the new governor, Cevdet Bey in Van. When Bramyan was informed in early October 1914 by a prominent Van businessman, Avedis Terzibashian, that Ömer Naci had threatened the Armenians with massacre if they supported Russians, he would shrug his shoulders and say, I quote, he is crazy and a drunkard, unquote. Ex post facto, one should not come to an easy conclusion and call him naive or visionless, but rather we should try to understand his self-confidence, which was stemming from the party's power in the province. As the clashes began in northwestern Iran after November 1914, a precarious utilitarian balance between the sides would still continue, yet without mutualism. As Bramyan stated in his January 26, 1915 letter to the new governor, Cevdet Bey, the sides would continue to negotiate, even after the war started, rather at a non-friendly, entirely distrustful manner. The government was simply in a position, by the way, I have to open a parenthesis here. At that time, the Ittihadis regime was refusing to have any contact with Taşnak student in Constantinople, and there was no contact elsewhere. So one is quite unique and exceptional in this sense. The government was simply in a position to continue its conversation with the ARF leaders, Taşnak leaders, because of the ARF's capacity to resist in the province. As of December 1914, the exterminationist intentions of the CUP, or of the Ittihadis, was all clear to the Taşnak student in Van. Yet, interestingly, the dialogue between the sides would still continue, and ARF leaders would be sent by the government to calm erupting crises between the soldiers and Armenian militia in districts such as Pelu, Timar, in the countryside. This also explains why, even as late as April 1915, İşhan, one of the three leaders of the party in Van, would be requested to go to Shatak to establish the calm there after the clashes between the gendarmes and the Taşnak militia broke out. And he would not suspect that it was a conspiracy. In any case, as the war broke out, the Taşnak committee in Van found itself at the center of increasing tensions. The party leaders tried diligently, on the one hand, to calm the tensions down, and on the other, endeavored to keep the self-defense network intact. They were at least successful in the latter part, and managed to keep a viable power parity in the most parts of the province. Yet, as the clashes eventually spread all over the province after the İşhan's killing and Bramyan's arrest in early April, it meant a final threshold for the perpetrators was crossed in the direction of doability of a genocidal campaign. Because Van was probably the only place that Armenians had the means and some kind of capability to resist. The only Armenian area where the victim group could effectively defend itself was already a battle zone. What followed was the extermination campaign of the CUP, of the Ittihadis, all over the Ottoman country. Let me now move to Van in 1915. In 2 weeks from today, Ara Sarafian will be speaking on the on his translation of Ado's monumental book, Met Tepkere Baspuraganum. So I will keep my description of this of the period very brief. It should be underscored that Armenian genocide had major geographical variations. Within the intricate landscape of panorama, the province of Van in the spring and summer of 1915 has a very distinct place. Van is the first place in the empire where intercommunal coexistence entirely and violently collapsed. Between August 1914 and April 1915, the political barometer in the province measured the growing tensions along the fault line that stretched from the Russian southern Caucasus and northern Iran to Istanbul through Van. Van was the epicenter of the Armenian genocide, the place where it incubated. It's also the site in the Ottoman Empire where the genocidal intent of the Young Turk government first materialized. It was the ruling Young Turk elite's fantasy of an imminent Armenian conspiracy that triggered the so-called Armenian Rebellion in April 1915. The consequent self-defense Iknabashpanutyun took shape with unprecedented success in this context. The Armenian defense of Van in April 1915 serves as a rare episode where a community under existential threat amalgamated and intracommunal diversity blurred. After the killing of Ishkhan and the arrest of Van deputy Arshak Vramyan, the Dashnak leadership was pretty much paralyzed. Hence, Armenek Egaryan, the leader of the Armenekan party's chief, led the military committee, which was a non-partisan body. Van Armenians managed to resist the government's utterly exterminationist repression in the city and other districts in the province. Yet, the Ittihadis would turn their failure to kill the Van resistance as one more justification to depict its Armenian subjects as internal enemies. Van became the first Ottoman province to fall under Russian occupation in May 1915. And a regional Armenian government was created by the Russian commander, who appointed the only surviving Dashnak leader, Aram Manukyan, and a Russian expat as the governor, and assigned him to form an exclusively Armenian government. Above and beyond its unique political significance, Armenian governorship in Van between May, July 1915 presented an historical irony. At a time when the rest of Ottoman Armenians were being subjected to widespread arrests, deadly deportations, and unprecedented massacres, Van Armenians were building their own rule in the province. For 74 days, 100,000 Armenians of the province, largely cut off from the rest of the country, and with extremely limited knowledge of the ordeal of Ottoman Armenians outside of Van, lived in a new political cosmos. In 1915, the entire power structure in Van swiftly and radically changed hands between Ottoman army and Kurdish irregulars and Russian army and Armenian militia multiple times in a matter of few months. Further, unlike other provinces of the empire, in Van, all groups suffered more or less comparable destruction. Reliability of statistical data from the period is disputable, yet only during the exodus and in the following few months, 1/3 of Van Armenians perished, along with an unknown number of Assyrians and Yazidis. I would like to open a parenthesis here. Looking at the genocide from Van underscores an important point. That is, the genocide did not target only Armenians. Assyrians and Yazidis were definitely among the victims. We can now sum up the larger contours of the story of Van. The liberation of the city came after Vanetti's month-long life and death struggle, which had united Armenians of all walks of society and save them from imminent destruction. The formation of the Armenian government had raised the hopes of one Armenians who had long yearned for security of life, property, and dignity. During the days of Armenian rule, the axis of conflict proved not so simple as Muslims against Armenians. Armenian itself proved once again a far from unitary or singular category, as all political and factional rivalries between the Dashnaks and Armenians reemerged. And in turn, an entirely new set of conflict of interest surfaced between the local Armenians and those who came from the Caucasus. The selection of new officials, controversial policies of the government, and corrupt practices created a wide spectrum of discontent among the Vanati. Another significance of the Armenian governorship was that it was the first Armenian nation-state experience. Here, I should also note that many leaders of the Van administration would later take important posts in the first Armenian Republic in 1918, such as Aram Manukyan, Siragan Dikranian, Sarkis Araratyan, to cite only a few. The Tsarist Russian Caucasian military command hardly had the well-being and security of Ottoman Armenians as a concern on their agenda. On July 17, 1915, the Russian military authorities abruptly and forcibly ordered all Armenians to withdraw from Van. Armenians of Van were once again united, this time against the Russian commander's order to withdraw. Despite requests and protests by Armenian commanders, and although the existing Armenian armed forces, it was around 10,000 by the way, were quite capable of defending the province against an attack, the Russian commander was resolute. Ironically, it was only 2 weeks later that the infamous governor, Cevdet Bey, reclaimed the city with a force of only 50 horsemen. And in mid-August, the Russian armies retook the city without any significant resistance. The unexpected retreat, which many Armenian leaders then blamed, was part of an organized conspiracy by the Tsarist Russia, had momentous consequences for Armenian history. Most importantly, it marked the end of thousands of years of Armenian presence in the province as a social unit. Second, during the retreat, tens of thousands of Van Armenians perished on the way due to harsh conditions and Kurdish attacks. It's difficult to say if the Russian decision had the intent of destroying the Van Armenian community. In any case, this example opens a window or the Pandora's box of responsibility. Unfortunately, one of the ways Turkish denialism has hijacked the efforts for a more nuanced understanding of the genocide is by hypnotizing us around perpetratorship. We are at a moment in the field of Armenian genocide studies that we should put aside to responding to denialism. The answer to the question of who the perpetrators were is quite straightforward. It has long been blocking the way, this question though, it has long been blocking the way for asking the more daunting question of who were responsible. In this presentation, I tried to offer an alternative interpretation to the history and memory of Van Baskurakan, in which Armenians are always active agents, as rebellious clerics, as philosophers, as bourgeois elite, as politicians, as revolutionary fedayis, as heroic resistors, as party chiefs pursuing realpolitics, as corrupt officials, as ambitious sectarian partisans, as governors, and of course, as a group of people fighting against oppression. I do this intentionally because I resist to reproduce the erasing shadow of the genocide. I do this to capture images of Armenian presence and legacy in Van Baskurakan, where Armenians have continuously reshaped the social, the economic, the political, for better or worse. Were they also victims? Absolutely. But the legacy of Crimean Hayrik and Portukalya haunted Van Baskurakan to the end. Van Armenians were not docile victims, but they were victims who rejected victimhood. To sum it up, the genocidal landscape of Van has left only losers behind. And a dead historic city, a city of inviolable beauties, a city of kings and gods, a city of orchards and water springs, a city of 1,000 years of labor, a city of millennia of coexistence that endured Mongolian invasion, that endured the great earthquake of 1648, that endured the great fire of 1876, that endured the famine of 1880s, that endured the Hamidian massacres, could not endure the man-made disaster of the genocide. That glorious one has died, only to be revived in the imaginations of the people longing afar, in the memoirs of Avedis Terzibashian, in the songs of Hagop Ter Hagopian, in the paintings of Aşil Gorki and Panos Terlemazyan, and in the novels of Mahalev, and also in our conference room today. Thank you very much.
Period leading up to the genocide. I'm sure there are lots of questions here in the audience. We have time for a few now, and of course we can continue them afterwards over coffee. But do people have questions for Dr. Turkulaz at this moment?
Absolute Kurdish majority. We are talking about the statistics around Kurdish population in Turkey is they're not reliable. But currently, probably, we're talking about around 70-75% Kurdish majority.
And when they take over,
They were already there. Kurds were there. Armenians were perhaps the relative, they made the relative majority. The second biggest group were Kurds.
I mean,
for this presentation, it's mostly Armenian memoirs, ARF archives, Dashnaksun archives, and Armenian newspapers published in. The cultural life in Van was very vivid before the genocide. That's good for us, because they left behind lots of documentation. For example, there were two biweeklies in Van published before the genocide, Ashkadan and Van Dost. And so many Armenians later wrote their memoirs. There's also a good collection at the National Archives of Armenia on Van. For this presentation, most of my, probably we're talking about 90% Armenian sources.
At one point, you mentioned gypsies in the area of Baspuragan. We don't often hear about gypsies in Armenian literature. Could you give us a little background as to where they came from? Were they?
First of all, gypsies are all over. There's of course the theories about where they came. But this is a very beautiful. I love that question because so it would give me an opportunity to comment or make another say something else. There's a group of gypsies. First of all, gypsies, people call them Roma gypsies, but they don't call themselves, they don't have one name. They have varying names depending on where they live. And there was one group of gypsies who spoke Armenian. And some of whose villages, until recently, and some were in Kastamonu, they still speak Armenian. And I think a few really elderly people are left. So, in Van, I think the gypsies spoke both Kurdish and Armenian.
Where they come from?
There are the theories that they came from India, but that's the really old story, that old history. But they were there. Some were settled, some were nomadic. But they were in Van. They were living more or less. They were part of that system. Social network.
Is it right that there is a lot of oil near Van?
Oil? I've not heard of any oil reserve or any kind of that activity. Recently.
Near Van Lake or
Basra? I don't.
This is the question. Is there any Jewish kind of influence under the whole thing?
Let me put it this way. There was a Jewish minority. Not everywhere. There were some in the city center. There were some small community towards the Iranian border. And unfortunately, we don't know much about the effect. And in denial sources, they oftentimes, particularly McCarthy does that, blame Armenians for massacring the Jews of Van. Unfortunately, I've not come across any such documentation in the story of Van. But we don't also, we need further studies on that. Unfortunately, as it is, Jews and Gypsies of Van are among the least studies. And recently, in the recent decades, we have more studies on Assyrians, for instance. And there's a booming literature on Kurds, but again, still, that's a beautiful question. So we don't have much. We still need more work on that.
We have to ask the rabbi.
Why do you think Israel in the 1800s, the Armenians felt the need to form groups like the Armenians and the Tashnak Zadans? Why did they feel that they needed to defend themselves? And why were they missionaries in the area? What was happening?
Okay, beautiful questions. And difficult to answer. Let me start with the formation of early political parties. I'm sure you know the history of Armenian question. There was already a problem there, a brewing problem. And there is the suffering. And there is, you combine suffering with know-how. Know-how meaning ideology. And know-how comes from, that's the intellectual work, right? And then comes inspirations like Krimyan or Portugalia. And when you deem that, when you think that you can or you should resist, then here comes the movement. Of course, for each case, for Social Democrat Rinchat, for Hayhavan Program, Tashnak Studio, and for Armenian, I need to say different things because they are their bases were different. Their traditions or their ideological affiliations are kind of different. But this is, if you look at the issue from one, that's what I can say. And the second question, can you repeat that?
Missionaries.
Missionaries. Missionaries were there for an obvious reason. So they wanted to convey their message. But missionaries, the relationship with missionaries and Armenian communities was actually it's not easy to say that there was one kind of relation. There were a good part of the church was quite very much disturbed by their activities. But there were other segments. It's not that missionaries were always trying to convert everyone, right? You could still a part of their institutions, use their hospitals, and schooling, but not convert. And some political organizations actually had developed good relations. But that doesn't change the fact that, for instance, in Erzurum, where there was a more sizable Protestant community, and also some Catholics. I'm not confident, this comment is not about the missionaries, but these three groups, interestingly, lived as if there were three different, separate ethnic groups, right? It was only during the 1910s and active efforts of the revolutionaries that there was some kind of rapprochement. But finally, once again, during the, for example, the resistance in one, missionaries basically try their best to help the victims. And they also left us a good documentation of what happened. But again, I mean, that's the issue which we can debate on forever.
You talk more about the Legion of Bonn. Did you have any comments about the siege of the city of Bonn itself for 30 days? And at what time did the Turkish armies be able to penetrate? And then how does that relate to the then falling under the Russian Empire, right? And the order to evacuate?
You know what? I mean, and that's actually important, of course. You know, if you study one, that's one thing like that you have to focus. But since Ara is coming in 2 weeks, I left that, and his topic is 1915. So I wanted to leave that topic to him. I mean, we can talk about that once he's here. That's why I left it there. But again, I mean, I try to show that, when we reconstruct history, we think that there is the Armenia. There is not Armenia. There are also institutions. And those institutions have their own interests, right? For example, Ramgavars have their own interests, which they believe and advocate that overlap with the interests of the nation. That was true for other groups, right, for everyone, right? And actually, at the end of the day, you know, they call their institutional interests as the nation's interests. That was the everyday in one until the resistance. Resistance, the moment that amount of resistance was a really exceptional episode in history of Van Armenians, because that was a moment that everyone united. And after that 30 days, you see the cracks coming up again, you know, back to the usual, And then, complaints, protests. So overall, what I'm trying to say is, rather than trying to, ethnicize the actors, we need to probably institutionalize them. I mean, to see that, these people, Armenians cannot do it. Armenians is not an actor. But a party can be an actor with its, cadres and committees and everything. So one of my efforts is to give sociological and psychological depth to the actors who do politics, who write history.
And the timing of the fault, the Turkish.
And then
the Russian occupation. What's the time?
By the 4th of May, the first group by Hecho arrived in one. That's a picture, probably some of you would recall that the cavalry, with horses and trees entering one. There's a famous picture, and the Armenians started digging trenches on the fourth, fifth of April, and by 7th of April, 6th, 7th of April, the first clashes began. It was a 1 month long.
Thank you very much for coming.